more interactive discussion going if you take a seat further up. My name is Bernard Hartmann. I'm a partner at Oliver Wyman in Dubai, where I am responsible for the energy business of the firm in the Middle East and in Africa. I'm very happy today to really present a distinguished panel of industry experts. To my right, Mr. Didier Hollot is Executive VP Strategy, Technology Projects, Solutions from ENGIE. We have Mr. Klaus Schäfer, the CEO of Uniper, and Mr. Gert-Jan Langhorst, the CEO of GasTerra from the Netherlands. Before I go into the content, a few housekeeping notes at the beginning. We have 1 hour and 15 minutes, and I have been asked by many to be sharp to finish at 1 o'clock. So after this brief introduction, I will start with a round of statements from the panelists to look at their perspective on the European gas market and what needs to happen going forward. And that's why I'm quite glad that we have this close proximity here in that small room. I hope we get a strong interactive discussion with many questions from the panel. And then the last 10 minutes, as usual, closing remarks. Let me start briefly with a summary from my perspective. And living in Dubai, it's quite an outside-in perspective when it comes to the European gas market. But gas clearly, as a primary energy source, has a strong role to play in a low-carbon world going forward. And we all know why. 50% less carbon dioxide emission than coal. It is a very flexible energy source, specifically in a potential role as backup for renewables. And it's abundant. It's abundant all around the globe. And I see also what's happening in the shale gas revolution in the US will unlock further reserves all around the world. In the last 2 days, we heard very strong and interesting signals about the role gas will play. If you remember the keynote sessions yesterday, where Amin Nasser, CEO of Aramco, stated that he will spend $300 billion in the next decade alone investing into gas reserves, mainly in Saudi Arabia. When you listen to Bob Dudley from BP, his list of investments are very much gas-centric. And of course, we heard the announcement of the Turkish Stream, which will bring additional transportation capacity into Europe. But on the other hand, when you look at the 2016 IEA report that came out this summer, the short-term outlook for gas is anything but rosy. We have a substantially slower gas demand growth in the past. Globally, in the US, in Europe, in Asia specifically, the demand in the big gas markets in Korea and in Japan have slowed down. On the other hand, you have more and more upstream and LNG capabilities coming online. These are all investments that have been taken in a completely different price scenario 2-3 years back. So all that points towards what I think is a very, very competitive environment for gas going forward. Now, looking forward, rebalancing of the gas markets is, of course, one of the topics of great interest. Most of us often look what's happening in oil. That's the market that gets the most attention, and we probably see the first indications now for a slow rebalancing. 2018 might be the time when supply-demand balance is achieved. But again, for gas, the IEA sees oversupply well into the next decade. And then again, that sits on past investment decisions that will bring quite price inelastic gas into the markets. But we also, of course, see structural changes on the demand side. You see the big wave of renewables coming into most mature markets. And also energy efficiency becomes now a very much supported driver in the market. So in summary, as I see it, challenging times ahead for the gas markets. But let's hear in a lot more detail from the people that are shaping this market. Mr. Schaefer, you're also now the newly elected president for Eurogas, so I would like to ask you for a first statement on the gas markets.
I'm very happy to do that, and a welcome from my side. Obviously, if you look at the title, you ask yourself, I mean, why are we asking that question? Yeah, because in sustainability of European gas markets, I mean, the question mark is lacking, but implicitly, I guess it's in the title of that session. Because if we were to look simply from the outside on a snapshot of the European market, it could all be so simple. I mean, Europe is one of the by far largest interconnected gas markets in the world. It has a fantastic standard of infrastructure. It has a high level of security of supply. It has diversified sourcing. It has very sort of like well-developed rules and regulations in the market. It went through sort of a series of deregulation steps, and therefore at least most countries are now firmly in a situation where we can say that the gas market is liberalized, and therefore that question in itself, you may say, why do we even worry about the sustainability of European gas markets? It should all be so clear. And I think the question and the statement here of that panel here really comes about because, yes, indeed, there is a situation right now where I and a couple of other people, obviously, as well, believe that we're somewhat at crossroads in our industry with regards to Europe. Why? Because there is a significant shift in supply demand in the sense that the indigenous production is declining, new gas sources have to be looked at, new gas has to be imported into Europe, and in order to attract that new gas, you have to have a firm picture going forward what the situation of that market is, what the outlook is, because new gas typically requires new investments, and I'm sure we also will talk about in that panel about the investment case into various parts of the value chain in terms of European gas. And in order to attract that, you not only need industry that has a clear picture of the future, you obviously also have to have a view of the other stakeholders, namely politicians and namely the countries and ultimately also the EU Commission in terms of what is the outlook for gas in Europe. There sort of like we simply see divergent or sort of like pictures that are not always overlapping and coherent. Why am I saying that? On the one hand, there are clear statements that gas is needed in Europe as a driver of the change in the energy transition, while at the same time, when it comes about attracting new gas, and I simply take as an example the publication by the European Commission in terms of its LNG strategy, and that whole document was about how to attract LNG into the European market, and therefore how to drive investment. At the same point, sort of like that was probably the one political paper out of the European Commission that had the worst outlook in terms of demand. And therefore you ask yourself, I mean, with that picture, if you show that at the same time, how do you want to attract the investment? And therefore, let's focus on exactly what is important in the European market, what drives that demand, and why sort of like gas should have that strong role. I guess that's easy for us in the industry to say it should have that role, but I think there are also some very clear arguments on that topic. And those arguments, and again, it's always good in my view to follow on the basic fundamentals of an energy market and therefore really the triangle of what's important in terms of having that functioning energy market, meaning affordability, meaning the environmental impact of that, and meaning then also the security of supply of that particular part in the energy value chain. And if we look at it from a security of supply point of view, I think right now, as I said, we're still in a very good situation. Security of supply of gas in Europe, I guess I could say, is better than ever. And it's certainly a lot better than the power system, for example. And given that I run both a gas and a power company, I can compare that extremely well. in terms of short-term reliability, in terms of long-term reliability, with the storage that is there, with the large amounts of regas capacities in Europe. Therefore, both short-term or sort of like long-term requirements on security of supply are today extremely well manageable. At the same time, we have a tremendous amount of diversity of supply in terms of the gas sources and more infrastructure in the wings. If I look at both privately financed as well as publicly financed projects that are sort of like to be executed over the next years. Question mark for me there, and I think that is something that we should probably also debate, is that security of supply sustainable at current prices? I mean, will sort of like storage, for example, always be available going forward if the market prices currently do not reflect that? A great security of supply situation is something positive right now, but it always raises the question of the future, will that be always the case? Topic of environment and therefore the impact that gas has in terms of reducing emissions and therefore improving the climate situation, I think we should not forget here that gas is the most efficient and the lowest cost solution towards decarbonization in the short term, i.e. sort of like a fast solution. Yeah, with gas, the short-term impact you can generate across all three sectors, transportation, heating, as well as power generation, is significant, and therefore, when we look at sustainability of European gas markets, that is one of the key issues we need to look at, and I'm sure we will discuss transportation. I'm sure we'll discuss, I mean, Europe still has 25% of its generation coming from coal, and therefore there's a tremendous amount of gas that can still penetrate parts of the value chain, and therefore towards the decarbonization, I think it can make a very, very strong contribution. And then from a cost point of view, yeah, let's not forget, I mean, the renewables is certainly sort of like the technology that will drive and influence, I mean, the energy transition in Europe and also obviously beyond Europe. At the same time, it needs sort of like a partner that sort of like is there for the flexibility that renewables, at least today, can certainly not provide yet, and at the same time also be a partner that drives low-cost applications. We can sort of like, put the whole sort of like heating system at home on the electric basis. I mean, technically that is feasible. Yeah? And there are enough people who talk about the full electrification of homes. All great. If you then look at the costs of that, you ask yourself sort of like, is that really the most efficient deployment of capital? Or sort of like, should you not simply combine the benefits of gas with those of renewables and therefore really create that partnership that we believe is the one that could drive the market really going forward. Therefore, on those three topics, I think gas clearly has a very strong role to play. It needs to be clearly advocated, it needs to be clearly stated, it needs to be adapted also by politics, and at least for 2030 and beyond, we should have a clear view in terms of what do we want. Then I have no doubts that we will see that sustainability in European gas markets. But again, there are crossroads right now, and therefore I think it is important that industry and politics get united in terms of what they really want from the gas market. Thank you.
Thank you, Herr Schäfer. I think WEC would have been very well advised to have some politicians with us here on stage. I think that would have brought a very different dialogue together, I would assume. Mr. Hlo, can I ask you for your perspective on the European gas market?
I will make it short. A few years back, International Energy Agency published a book which was called The Golden Age of Gas. And that was not a present to the gas industry because a lot of people went to sleep thinking that they didn't need to do anything because Golden Age of Gas will happen. And the truth is Golden Age of Gas is not happening if we don't fight for it. And I think it's time that the gas industry wakes up and decide to fight for making the golden age of gas happening. Because if we don't do anything, then, you know, some of you have certainly seen this film by, this movie by Al Gore about disturbing trust. And Al Gore starts by saying, the ex-future president of the USA. Gas could be tomorrow the ex-future energy of the energy transition. We can miss the train if we don't fight for giving gas its true place in the energy transition. And that means, first, that we have to make sure that gas is competitive. I don't say that only because Mr. Lankhorst, who is one of our suppliers, is together with me today, but we have to have gas which is competitive with other sources of energy. That means also that carbon price have to be set at a price where we will eliminate coal from the European market. If we don't do that, we are not serious about energy transition. Coal is the number one enemy, and we need to kill it. Third, we have to give to all our fellow citizens this very clear message that gas is the renewable's best friend. A bit like diamonds are the girl's best friends. Gas is the renewable's best friend because when you have a lot of renewables, you need a lot of reliable sources to supply power on the network when renewables are not producing. Because wind is intermittent, sun is intermittent, and therefore you need reliable sources. In some countries, you have nuclear power. In some other countries, just because it takes 15 years to build new nuclear power plants, you need CCGT, you need a combined cycle gas turbine. Gas is also renewables' best friend because more and more we will develop green gas, biogas today, perhaps hydrogen tomorrow. And this biogas, this hydrogen will contribute to make gas globally a greener energy. If we succeed in making this condition happen, if we also fight for a place for gas in the transport business as a fuel, be it as compressed natural gas, be it as LNG, then we will succeed in making the golden age of gas happening in Europe. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Can I ask you to close that first round with your perspective, maybe also addressing the question that was just raised on the competitiveness of gas?
Thank you. Yes, I will try to not to repeat what has been said, because I agree on very much what as well Klaus as DJ have just said. So let me try just to fill in some of the gaps. Yes, indeed. Some 5-6 years ago, there was this IEA publication on the golden age of gas. But just a few years later, there was a serious concern in Europe on the availability of gas. There was a crisis, Russian gas not coming through Ukraine. And it's just 3 years ago that the European Commission did serious stress tests to see whether European gas infrastructure, the system, the contractual situation could take care of security of supply in Europe. And the outcome of that study was, for some maybe surprisingly, that the situation in Europe is, in fact, quite good. There's just a very small part of Europe where people are entirely dependent on gas from just one source. On a total market of 400, 500 billion cubic meters of gas in Europe, there's just a market segment of between 20 and 30 BCM, which is entirely and only reliant upon Russian gas. The rest of Europe has access to gas from all kinds of regions, more than one source at least. I think that is a good starting point. And if you look at the way the European market developed over the past decades, it is now a market that is very competitive and very well functioning in most of Europe, especially in the Northwest. But the competition is spreading out to the East and to the South, and more markets have now access to liquid hubs where the price of gas is determined by demand and supply. So that's a good starting point. When we talk about infrastructure, we should not forget that most of the infrastructure in Europe is regulated. So talking about investment climate, it depends very much on decisions of regulators, what tariffs they allow, and so on. But the situation is, in most parts of Europe, not so bad, especially in the central and eastern countries and in the southern countries, the Mediterranean regions. We need more interconnection capacity, but I think we're on the right track there. So if you look at it from an, let's say, traditional perspective of how to advocate for gas, we should say, well, supply is there, access to supply is there, infrastructure is there. The only thing we have to do is to convince consumers and politicians that gas is good. And it's a triple A, it's abundant, it's available, it's affordable, and so on. It's acceptable for environmental reasons. But somehow, in Europe, that kind of argumentation, that kind of logic, doesn't seem to work anymore. We need to focus more on the consumer side and see what is driving consumers. And, well, let's be honest, most consumers are not very interested themselves. It's their politicians for which they vote that decide on the regulations of the gas market. What is driving them? What is their concern? And why is the political environment at the moment not friendly for gas in Europe? I think that is the core question that we have to focus on. And if you look into that question, I think it has to do with the struggle that politicians have on where to go with their energy policies. There is a strong belief in Europe, and I share that belief, that we need a transition to a more sustainable energy system, that we need to reduce CO2 emissions. And if you have that conviction, in fact, the way to make that transition work is quite easy. Set strong targets on CO2 emissions and let the market do the things that are necessary to reach those targets. What we have in Europe is a system where there is not one target. There's not a single target, but there are three targets currently. For 2020, we have the 2020-20 targets. Not only a CO2 target, but also a renewables target and an energy efficiency target. And that is now confusing quite a lot, because many people think the only way to reach the targets is to have more renewables. But that's not true. CO2 reductions can be achieved by fuel switch, can be achieved in a more cost-effective manner than just by investing in renewables. So setting this one target, well, let me illustrate it by the functioning of the ETS. We say, and I share that, the ETS today is not functioning. But the ETS is designed to bring Europe to a CO2 reduction that we have agreed upon. And the fact that the CO2 price is now so low in the ETS means that we are on track to meet the CO2 target. Maybe not fast enough in our view, but we're still on track. Today I read in the Dutch newspaper that, surprisingly, Holland, which is seen by most of its politicians as a country that does very poor in making the energy transitions, hey, we seem to be on track with regard to CO2 reductions. It's a surprise, but if you look at the figures, it's logical. We are helped by that, by the economic recession of the past years, which has made the industry grow less than we expected, but we are on track. So my view for the future is that we have to focus on a single CO2 target and let the market do everything that is cost effective to reach that target. What is then the role of gas? First of all, by fuel switch to the most clean fossil fuel is, of course, helping you very much in reaching your target. But then, that's not enough. Because if we go beyond the targets for 2020 and 2030, and we look at 2050, where not only the European ambition, but the G20 ambition is to have an 80 to 95% CO2 reduction, then also we have to change the role of gas. We need a different role of gas. Gas cannot be used just the way it is today. Gas will have more a role to balance the system. Gas will have to be cleaner in itself. We need to use more biogas, green gas, made from agricultural waste or other forms of biomass, because it's not sustainable. It will not reach the 80 to 95% target if we keep using gas in the amounts that we have today. So I think the gas industry has to enter deeper into that debate, has to develop alternatives way of using gas, alternative appliances and so on, to make our story that continuing on a path with more gas in the European energy mix is a credible story and will help us to reach the long-term targets in CO2 emissions.
Thank you very much for these initial statements. Mr. Law, you clearly mentioned the fight for the gas industry for its role, and I understand it will be a fight on multiple fronts. On one hand, you need to convince ultimately the consumers that gas is a viable, is a very attractive source of energy for them. You need to shape the agenda of politicians through the consumer's demand, I would assume. But ultimately also there is a strong role for innovation, for new applications that are critical. We've seen that when we look at learning curve effects in the energy industry, renewables, lithium-ion batteries and so forth. Also gas needs to provide this kind of innovation going forward to be more competitive. I have a question for you, starting with Mr. Schaefer. I just came out of a panel discussion where specifically in the German State Secretary Barke mentioned for the transportation sector in Germany, he sees 2030 at the latest a zero emission transportation sector. How feasible is something like that in the context of the German setup?
So it's a delicate question. I think between, signaling, if you want to set sort of like a direction, sometimes that is best done by setting a very sort of like tough and very ambitious target, and you worry then over time whether you can actually reach that or not. Plus, it's always nice to say, if you set targets 15 years out, it's unlikely that you yourself will be held accountable for those targets, and therefore, unfortunately,
that's a very fair point.
Unfortunately, as a CEO, you're never allowed to do that. Mm-hmm. You have to set targets for the next decades. People ask you, what's the target for next year and for the years to come? Therefore, I guess I would be a bit skeptical whether that is achievable. I'm someone who says, yes, on the transport side, we need to see significant change going forward. Part of that change will be obviously e-mobility and therefore the use of electrical energy for that. But part of that will also be, and therefore, I think I said that earlier, I think this jump from sort of like these digital jumps, I'm not a big believer in, to say, we go from where we are today to zero emissions then. Let's work towards reducing the emissions today. I think that is what makes the impact. If I see what we're doing and others are doing, for example, in using gas, LNG in heavy-duty vehicles, there's a tremendous amount of reduction that you can achieve on CO2, but on top of that also in terms of particles and other emissions, and therefore really sort of like make these heavy-duty vehicles sort of like accessing also the large towns without having the impact that it has today. And therefore, it's those changes where you can see the impact already today. We were just at the International Car Exhibition in Frankfurt. We had the large truck. It's amazing to see sort of like the interest that's generated by that. And therefore, let's drive these topics. Mm-hmm. And then let's worry sort of like 5 years out, what's the next step, rather than setting those targets that, again, are for the next generation.
Can I add something? I drive in a beautiful German car, a very comfortable car, on gas, on natural gas. There are many points where I can take fuel that is not natural gas, but it's biogas, it's green gas. And it's, the performance is the same. So I think that is a climate neutral way of driving, which is possible already today. Of course, if all Dutch people and German people would switch to such a car today, there would not be enough supply, so that's not what's going to work. But the focus on electrical vehicles is one where, we look at what comes out of the car itself, but the electric power has to be produced as well. And today, most of that is done in coal-fired power plants. So whether it's that clean, you have to look at the whole system, of course. Secondly, there is potential in shipping. LNG in the ships that that are on the rivers in Europe. You know, CO2 emissions, people cannot smell them, people cannot feel them or whatever. But the other emissions that ships make today with the diesel and the bunker fuels that they use, that is a tremendous gain for the environment if you have them on LNG. So I think that market is a huge potential. It's developing rapidly now. The break bulk technologies and small scale technologies for LNG are really improving. In Rotterdam, they have now made the whole facilities to fuel the ships. And I think that will be a major contribution to the whole environment, the air quality in Europe.
Absolutely. Thank you both for your comments. Mr. Locke, coming back to your statement earlier on the fight for gas, you mentioned carbon price to change the economics of coal. When I look at renewables, they have really benefited from a very strong policy support in Europe. Beyond carbon pricing, do you see any other policy support that would be immediately needed for gas?
I don't think that we should think in terms of policy support. I mean, if people have in mind subsidies, that's not what we are considering. But what we should be asking for is a market design for gas in Europe, which will be thought having in mind security of supply, supplying power when the renewables are not supplying power because of intermittency and things like that. Today, the gas market design in Europe has been still too much influenced by the electricity market design, and it has not been really designed in a proper way to make gas play its full role in the energy transition. So our first demand would be that the market design is really rethought and that we really redesign it to adapt it to the energy transition. There is, for instance, if we want to develop security of supply, there is an issue of who is paying for the LNG terminals when price movement makes that LNG terminals are not used. Because if we don't do anything, then the logic would be to close down the energy terminals, but then the LNG terminals. But then when, if the price of pipe gas increase, who will import? Where can you import LNG to compete for price? So all these issues about investment, capacity payment, and market design globally is something that should be worked on as a matter of emergency if we want gas to play its full role in the energy transition. Maybe I could add just one point to what my colleagues have said about gas, and namely LNG in the transport business. And that has to do with innovation. Today, as Klaus and Gertjan mentioned, replacing diesel by LNG in trucks is a very simple way to reduce emission for goods transportation. But today, you do it by just using existing motors and just putting LNG in these motors instead of diesel. If today the motor manufacturer work a bit more on their motor, you can do far better with LNG than you do with diesel, for a very simple reason. LNG is very cold, and if you inject a cold fuel in a motor, you increase compression and pressure, and therefore you can have a far better ratio of energy used compared to energy burned, and therefore you increase efficiency. That has not been done. It's not that complicated. We expect to have a car working on this principle running at Le Mans, 24 hours Le Mans this spring in France. And that's innovation that will increase efficiency and bring a better solution for goods transportation.
Thank you. I have one final question before I open up for questions from the audience. When I look at the press, when I see gas and its perception in the public view, it has, I would say, suffered a little bit, specifically in the context of the shale gas discussion in Europe. It's not where, when I grew up in Germany, you had these nice, cozy commercials that came through Ruhrgas on gas as the warm, fuzzy energy source of the future. And I think we need, as an industry, we need to come back to the consumer, and we need to shape that demand to some extent. Who in the industry is doing that? This is not a lobbying activity at all, but proactively really driving demand through a better image of gas. Do you see there is a need for that, or is that already done? I don't know. Please.
Well, as I said, I think if you really believe in the necessity of an energy transition, you should not lobby for more gas in the power mix or more gas in the energy mix just because you want more gas in there. You need to focus on what role will gas play. The credible position is that you only should apply gas where there is no cleaner alternative. And that is something difficult to say, because cost effectiveness is also of importance. So it's not just gas by default, it's gas by design, which is a more complicated position. But in order to keep a credible voice in the debate, I think that is important. And that means that you have to look at the different segments of the market. For power production, if as an alternative for renewables, gas is the ideal partner, and I think there's huge potential, but the price still has to be influenced a bit more by a good CO2 price. For heating households, it depends. It depends. I think if in a country like the Netherlands, where 98% of the buildings are connected to the gas grid, people are now saying, if we build new houses, should we have a gas grid there or not? Should we invest in a gas grid that will be there for 40 years, or should we invest in better isolated houses, in a warm water system, in heat pumps or whatever?
Yeah.
And I think they're right. And gas is not always the logical alternative there. But the debate in the politics in Netherlands is much further now. Is how fast can we remove gas from the built environment? Well, I think there it loses sense, because it costs quite a lot. It takes a lot of effort to you have to enter into every house to switch the appliances, to switch the whole system. I think that will never work. But that is where we are at the moment. There is so much pressure in some of the countries, and you can say, well, politicians make wrong decisions, but they're able to do so sometimes. And I think we have to make clear that we have better alternatives, but that we are not just saying we defend gas, whatever it takes. No, we look at the situation and see in every situation what is the best alternative.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think a differentiated message has to reach the consumer, and through the consumer, then ultimately the policymakers. Ladies and gentlemen, we are a little bit beyond halfway. I would like to open for questions, please. I do understand that there is also, from a technology perspective, the opportunity to type questions if you don't want to voice them. I have a little bit of a bet with myself if this will work or not. I'm looking here, but please go ahead.
Axel from Energy Exchange Istanbul. There was a quite debate yesterday about whether Turkey can be an energy hub or which country can be an energy hub in Southeastern Europe. So there's a strong will from the ministry and the regulator in Turkey, and we are planning to open up the established day at an intraday market. But I would like to ask you, what are your expectations? What are your requirements in order to trade in Turkey in Istanbul? Thank you very much.
Herr Schäfer.
I'm just not 100% sure I got the question because
my understanding. Let me try to.
On the podium, and actually, you hear the questions. I mean, the sound quality here is probably a lot worse than the sound quality that you enjoy from us. But I took it as Southeastern Europe. It's Turkey as a hub.
Yeah.
Was that the?
Allow me to briefly rephrase and correct me if I'm wrong. I think the question was: there's a lot of talk and discussion on establishing Turkey as a central energy hub in the region here. How viable do you see that is going forward?
What are your expectations in order to trade in Turkey or invest in Turkey?
I think it's as always sort of like relatively simple. I mean, hubs are developing where the market sort of like is there. Yeah, and there are a couple of elements that are crucial. I think hubs develop where you have sort of like certain infrastructure coming together. Yeah, so in the case of Turkey then, I mean, existing pipelines, new pipelines, obviously you have the Southern Corridor, you have Azerbaijan, and we heard the political address on Monday in terms of the link on the energy side between Azerbaijan and Turkey. You have the discussions on new pipelines also from Russia. You have the discussions on existing volumes that come. You have LNG discussions here in Turkey. So a lot of the ingredients on the infrastructure side, I think, are there. The next topic is obviously you need a large enough market here. Yeah, so therefore, I think the gas market, and there certainly is still a development potential in Turkey in terms of what can be done there, especially also on the power generation side, to really drive a flexible demand there. You need to have flexibility behind that. Therefore, the question, I mean, what's really storage capabilities here in Turkey, and therefore what swings can a hub sustain in order to be really efficient there? And then what's the link to the neighboring markets and neighboring hubs? Because obviously, a lot then is about arbitrage between the hubs, and can you efficiently also come to a price discovery then in the Turkish market? So I think that's the question of linking Turkey energy-wise, sort of like to Europe, and making sure that, for example, I mean, a pipeline like the TAP will link Turkey then with Italy, and therefore sort of like one liquid market, another liquid market, obviously would drive that. Therefore, the potential is certainly there, but I think I also gave a couple of ingredients that, from my point of view, would still have to be put in place to make that a real viable alternative.
Good morning, Paolo Dermo from World Energy Council Italy. We follow, as the Italian committee, the theme of LNG new uses. In Italy and Europe, and my question is for ENG first, and also for the others speakers on the possibility of new uses of LNG as direct fuel, also in the industry, as off-grid solutions. Because to our surprise, there are a lot of industries that today in our country, I don't know in your countries, are using oil products for industrial production. I mean food, beverage, and other kind of industries. And we see that in Italy there is a good space for a good room for the use of LNG instead of oil products. And the second comment is on the consumer perception of natural gas as a fuel, a greener fuel. It is true that gas is not perceived so green as electric cars, but in Italy we have the biggest fleet powered by natural gas, and I assure you that if you ask a consumer what you would like to buy, an electric car or a natural gas powered car, the cost is the main point, and they will reply, I would prefer a natural gas powered car. So there is a space, there is an issue of cost that is in favor of natural gas also in the transportation sector, and maybe on this point companies, institutions and all the stakeholders must do more, maybe.
Thank you for your questions. Let's start with the first one. I think it was for you, Mr. Olo.
Yes, the use of LNG for the industry is certainly something that we can develop in many places, particularly for places which are not connected to a natural gas grid and where LNG may be the only way to supply. This has been developed in Scandinavia. This is developing in continental Europe today, more and more in the Netherlands, in Germany, in France, in many countries. You can transport LNG by truck to industrial sites and supply it. It remains a relatively limited market, but it's an interesting market, and we gladly do it through our different affiliates in this business. Regarding the second issue on gas and transportation and the image of gas, well, as Gertjan said, we cannot claim that gas is not competing. We cannot ask gas to compete exactly on the same terms as electrical vehicles. First, if you look at the global chain, electrical vehicles are not that green. Second, if you look at only urban movements, then electrical vehicles are probably the right solution. But as soon as you get out of the city, then autonomy is an issue with electrical vehicles. And therefore, here you have to look for what may be seen as the second best solution, but compressed natural gas, LNG, hydrogen tomorrow, and so on, can be a very good solution. And the combination of fuel cell vehicles with electrical batteries may be also a very good compromise if you want more autonomy and you want to run on electric power. So I think, in a nutshell, for the individual vehicles, we have to be very pragmatic. We are not fighting head-to-head against electrical vehicles. We are saying there is room for everybody, and here diesel is the enemy, and we want to eliminate diesel because any solution we will bring will be better in terms of CO2, but also in terms of local pollution. NOx and SOx are greatly reduced, and particles. So be pragmatic, not compete head-to-head with pure electrical vehicles, but there is room for everybody in that respect.
Hello, Elisa Schenerdam from Argus Media. My questions would be to all the panelists. First of all, given staggering demand in Europe since around 2010, how are your companies planning to deal with the fact that they are overcontracted? And second, what trading opportunities do you see given oversupply that has already started from new markets, especially LNG providing countries. What role can Europe play in helping global gas markets balance? Are you looking at new markets to trade gas, like Ghana, Colombia, Philippines, any other destinations you're looking at? Thank you. Yeah, sure. So the first question is, how are your companies coping with the fact that demand is staggering and you are overcontracted?
And to the colleagues on the panel, my technical solution here is not a gas solution, it's an electrical solution. If you put on the headsets and switch to channel 2, you get the original language here, and actually we really can listen to it. And I think that actually works quite well here. Back to gas. I think the first question is, I think we all see the demand evolution. I think we also see the chances on the demand side going forward, because obviously on power generation, the topic of sort of like relative share in the mix has been addressed by the colleagues. So I do believe that there is an opportunity and upside, and also transport we just highlighted, which again provides upsides also on the demand side. Therefore, I mean, I cannot talk about the colleagues, but I think the word over-contraction, yeah, or is that I have sort of like a portfolio that is over-contracted, at least for myself, I can say I cannot see that. Mm-hmm. But again, I can only talk about my company in that respect. Second topic is really, I mean, the question then of the supply and demand balance. And indeed, obviously, we will see a certain amount of LNG coming into Europe. I think if you simply look at the global supply picture, Europe will be one or sort of probably the swing market that will be in a position to also take into those volumes. And yes, sort of like that may generate a bit more competition and also in Europe, but then sort of opportunities also get created by that. I mean, we look at sort of like gas and power generation, that is an issue of where are CO2 prices, but also where is gas relative to coal, and therefore, again, some more competition in the market may simply also mean that it has a positive impact on the demand side, and therefore, I think companies can benefit from that. Third topic is obviously what you said, I mean, linking markets. I do believe sort of like that LNG is a fantastic opportunity to link the European market to the global markets, and with the volumes coming onto the market, that will be obviously much stronger going forward, and therefore having the right portfolio in the European market with enough flexibility, enough storage, but also enough flexibility in your LNG portfolio to then trade that gas, I think that's the at least in our view, the concept that will be winning going forward.
To add to that, liquid markets, as we see developing in Europe, and certainly in Northwest Europe, we have a liquid price formation in the market, have a lot of advantages. The right price at the moment that you buy the gas, you're sure about that. But there's also a disadvantage that they don't give the long-term price incentives at the moment that you need for investments in gas infrastructure, because the lead times of investments are more than 1 year, and prices that long ahead on the curve are not as liquid as the short-term price. So that's a bit of a complication that we still have to deal with. But for the moment, as I said before, I see that Europe is in a situation where there's a lot of capacity to receive gas from all kind of directions, pipeline gas from the north and from the east and from the south, and LNG from everywhere on the world. And then it also brings me to the famous question, will Europe get LNG from the United States? Well, the interesting thing is that doesn't matter at all. If we have, as Klaus just said, an LNG market which is global, where gas is shipped around the globe, then it doesn't matter what is the exact source of the LNG. There is a price that will be balanced not only in Europe or in the US or in the Pacific, but there will be more arbitration between those regions. And that in itself will create a worldwide market which brings the right gas price to the consumer in the end.
First of all, thanks to all for your speech. You argued that competition is very important for Europe. Therefore, there is a good infrastructure for LNG. However, Europe also needs pipe gases. With respect to demand or consumption increase in Europe, how could you evaluate or summarize the importance of Middle East gases, West and Middle Asian gases, and also Russian gas over Turkey? You argued the opposition of Turkey, therefore I don't mention this point. How could you evaluate the pipe gases from east of Europe? Thank you.
From an industry point of view, important is that supply is available, and supply is available in excess of foreseeable demand. Then, as Gertjan said, it doesn't matter so much actually where the gas is coming from. Will it come from the Middle East? Will it come from Qatar? Will it come from the US? Will it come from any other place? At the end of the day, our customers do not care. What is important is that we have organized the system so that infrastructure are available, that gas supply is available, that contracts are in place to cover the base supply of our markets, and then, well, the market will play its role. So it's obviously each of us may have its opinion on competitivity of this source compared to that source and so on, but from an industry-wide point of view, the importance is that there are many sources, that they are in competition, that we don't foresee any shortage of gas in the short to medium term, or in medium to long term, I should say. And then, competition should play its role.
John Roberts with Methinks, and also Chief Analyst for Natural Gas World. Question. If you build infrastructure in Europe, it serves two main purposes. One, it promotes market development, particularly interconnectors. But secondly, you also sometimes need infrastructure to ensure security of supply in the event of disruptions. If, and I'm being hypothetical here, an energy connector of 5 BCM capacity is sufficient to ensure market development, but you need a pipeline of twice that size, or maybe more, to ensure security of supply in case of disruption. First of all, who should pay for such a difference? And secondly, how important do you consider it is? Then another final question. There's a popular impression that gas is a fossil fuel and therefore bad. We've just come through Brexit. We're facing an emotional election in the United States. How does one counter that kind of emotional argument when, as far as we can see, rational arguments that say that gas is actually a partner to renewables don't seem to be getting through?
If I may take the first one, who pays for investment for security of supply? It's all the issue of the market design. And it's all the issue of putting the priority of the European Union right. If we are concerned with security of supply, then one of the first features of the market design should be to settle who is paying for security of supply investment. And today, what we can say is that it's not properly done, that the European Union is speaking a lot about security of supply, but not actually putting in place the tools to organize it in the long run. Perhaps I leave to my colleagues to answer the second question about emotion and natural gas.
Maybe first an additional remark on this. If the analysis that you made on 5 BCM for market development and 10 BCM for security of supply, if you can make such an analysis so punctual, so precise, then I wish the European Commission would hire you as a consultant, because this is exactly what we need for projects of common interest. I think the way that process is going, it's good that we have the projects of common interest and that there is support by the European Commission for some infrastructural projects, especially in interconnectors that disclose markets. But the problem is that every project that is an interconnector is seen as a project of common interest, and that the real analysis of which are the top 5 or the top 10 projects in Europe is difficult to make. It's a difficult assessment, and then a lot of political interference comes in, and then it ends up with, well, if you get something, then that other country needs something too, and so on. So I wish there was a clear decision tree, which is so clear as the hypothetical question that you put before us, and I'm afraid there is not. So I think there is indeed a necessity for political intervention based on good assessment of what really the situation is. Now, coming to your second point, yes, that is for me at the moment the big question and the big thing that, especially in my country and in the northwest of Europe, we are trying to cope with. What we see is that, of course, we have those who represent, let's say, renewable energy interests and who are very strong believers in that the green future is around the corner and that we can make the transition within 10 or 15 years, who say gas should be out of the system as soon as possible. And it is very hard to have a dialogue with these people. But there are also people who really take a responsible look at the system, who know that if you want to make the energy transition, you don't have a program for the next 3 or 5 years, but you need a program for the next 30 to 50 years. So if you want to make the energy transition a success, it must be sustainable in itself. You must take the measures that are credible and that people will not regret 2, 3, or 5 years later. In Holland, there was a massive support scheme for hybrid cars a few years ago. If you would have a hybrid car, you could almost drive for free. But if you look at those cars, they drive 30 kilometers on electrical power, and then they start using normal fuels like petrol. And it was discovered then a few years later, there was a study that showed that this cost about 1,500 to 2,500 euros per ton of CO2 not emitted, whereas the price in the ETS is 5. And then all the voters said, who is responsible for this stupid decision? Who's responsible for these things, these policies that cost a lot but don't bring us a cleaner future? So I think those examples, we should also use them to make clear that energy transition is something that needs to be sustained for a long time and where cost effectiveness is extremely important.
Thank you. Thank you for your lectures. I would like to ask, with all due respect to your opinion, that it is not important that where the natural gas is coming from. Don't you think that according to decline of production in Europe, I mean about natural gas, Europe will be dependent on Russian gas in approaching years more and more, especially when we consider that although the third energy package was just legislated by European Commission, the Nord Stream was extended for the second project. Although the South Stream was suspended, nowadays we heard that Russia is going to have the Turkish Stream instead of South Stream. And although the specialists used to think that LNG from United States will be a good method for Europe to decrease its dependency on Russian gas, United States didn't send a lot of cargoes, LNG cargoes, to Europe. So don't you think that the dependency on Russian gas will be an obstacle for the politician to make a decision for increasing the role of natural gas in European market? And my second question is about Iran. It is predicted that Iran will increase its capacity, not the production, the capacity of production in approaching years as double. I mean, it is right now approximately 600 million cubic meter per day, and it is predicted that it will be increased till 1.2 billion cubic meter per day. So does Europe have any kind of plans for importing natural gas from Iran via LNG or via pipeline? Thank you so much.
I mean, obviously two sort of like a bit geostrategic topics that have been raised. I think the first one to me is a relatively simple answer. I do believe, and we've talked about this reduction in indigenous production in Europe, therefore there is an increased import need, and that import need, in my view, will have to come from all of the possible sources that we have in Europe today. It means, yes, sort of like we'll see much more LNG coming to Europe. It will also mean that, yes, sort of like we'll see gas from the Southern Corridor coming to Europe, and yes, indeed, sort of like in filling the gap, and simply sort of like if you take the current share of Russian exports into or imports from Russia into Europe, that's a sizable amount of gas that would be sort of like coming in addition from Russia. To me, it's important that we retain that diversification, that we have always the flexibility also to shift between volumes, because if that's the case, then indeed what the colleagues have said, it does not matter in the end. I mean, the molecule which arrives at your home does not have a sort of flag on it where it comes from. It's simply sort of like then part of the overall sort of import volume, with exception, I think, Gertjan, you said that of very few countries at the eastern border of Europe, where obviously there's maybe just one supplier, therefore the topic is more relevant. Also, this issue of dependency, this to me is sort of like a bit of a negative connotation. Dependency sort of like in this case, to me, is much more about a relative benefit from a relationship between an export and an import. I mean, ultimately, the gas exports are for Russian more important from an economic point of view than the imports into Europe. And therefore, dependency sounds always, if there is a one-sided relationship there, I do not believe that that's the case here. Therefore, I do see Russia having a firm role in the picture of supply into Europe, but it's just one supplier, and therefore would also not talk about over-dependency here. Iran sort of like is simply one of those countries that is now also, I mean, developing and planning ahead in terms of how some of the gas that they're having can be exported. And indeed, if these are LNG exports, some of that LNG may well, and why not, find its way into Europe. But this will simply be sort of like based on an open market that receives LNG from various sources. I mean, US, obviously, you rightly point out that there hasn't been a lot yet of US LNG. Now, if you look at how many cargoes have left the US so far, that's also a relatively a small amount still. I think the big ramp up we'll see in the years 18, 19 then to come. And I think that ultimately also more cargoes will find their way into Europe. And the more suppliers we have access to on a global basis from Europe, the better it is. Yeah, I think more is better in that case, and therefore I think Europe should be happy that it has that diversity and that access to global sources.
May I just compliment with an anecdote? 2 years back, I remember in Houston, a panel like that, representative of a U.S. company that I would not name today, said, well, due to export LNG from the U.S., we will bring security of supply to Europe. I just laughed and said, we have not waited for the U.S. to have security of supply in Europe, first. Second, I don't trust the U.S. to bring security of supply to anybody, because the day their national interest will be to stop exporting, they will do it like that. They did it for oil, they will do it for LNG the day they consider that their national interest is to stop exporting, what Russia have never done. That's about security of supply. You know, 40 years, 50 years of relationship is better than just great declaration of principle and freedom of trade and things like that.
Jalal Bouchneb from Sonatrach, Algeria. My question is about mobility. We have seen the first factor, which is price, and according to the competitiveness between using natural gas for mobility or electric vehicles, and also autonomy, and it is the greenest solution or not, but that's not all. There is one more issue, which is very important, and it's efficiency. We know as we convert gas in a natural directly in the natural gas engine, it's about 20% efficiency. But if you use that gas in a combined cycle, we get up to 60% efficiency. So we don't want to use that fuel. It's precious. So that factor should be taken into consideration. My question is there, have we seen lately progress in terms of efficiency in the natural gas engines? And what are the perspectives? Thank you.
First, on efficiency, you are right. Using gas in a combined cycle turbine is more efficient than in a motor. But we are not living in an ideal world. We are living in the true existing world. And the question we have is, how do we kill the public enemy number one, which is coal, and the public enemy number two, which is diesel? And the quickest way to kill them is to replace them with solutions which are immediately available. And this solution is gas. And gas, in any case, will be cleaner, will be at least as efficient, and as I said, it could become more efficient if you use the fact that LNG is in fact very cold. And so it's an immediate progress in terms of emission of CO2, in terms of emission of NOx, emission of SOx, and particles. So, yes, it would be even better to invent something even more efficient. But stop waiting for the miracle which will solve the issue in 10 years' time. Just work today, improve the situation today. Every single truck which is converting from diesel to LNG is improving, is reducing CO2 emission, is improving the air quality in our cities in Europe. That's the hard fact.
Thank you.
Well, my conclusion is clear. If we want the golden age of gas to happen, we have to fight for it. The first part of the fight is CO2 price. And if you ask me what lessons learned we should give to these countries which are thinking about developing gas and changing their energy mix, put a price on CO2 is the first piece of advice that we can give. Second is do something for transport, for mobility. Develop the solution. Innovate, replace diesel by gas. And third, develop green gas. If we do the three of these actions, then we may make a golden age of gas possible.
I mean, maybe just to briefly add, I think what came out today, and I think this to me is the number one issue, I mean, it has to be thought through from the eyes of the customer. So ultimately, it's the customer decide what he wants, either directly through his buying behavior or through voting for politicians that ultimately design a system that they like, and therefore the customer of experience of gas needs to be positive, and it will be positive if individually everyone who uses a device that ultimately sort of is driven by gas is seen as an improvement over the past, and therefore that something can be done. Therefore, the topic of innovation to me is really crucial, that is visible. The question of affordability, ultimately people will also want something where they believe they can afford that, and it's not just something for parts of the population, industry, whatever, but it's really something that serves to also fulfill the energy needs of everyone, and therefore also lessen, I guess, to the outside Europe, because certain things we can afford in Europe, maybe not everyone can do that, and therefore gas may play a different role. And then it's reliability. I mean, if you as a consumer invest into anything, you want to be absolutely sure that it's not redundant the next day, and therefore sort of like that visibility going forward in terms of sustainability of gas also in the market, I think that's the third element of the customer experience that I believe is important. And therefore, if we focus on that, then I believe, yes, we have a sustainable market going forward, and I think that needs to be the focus.
First of all, and I think that is important, it was also in some of the questions, I have made some critical remarks on political regulation of markets, but what has been achieved in Europe is a liquid gas market, and it's becoming bigger and more liquid every day. I think that's also the message for Turkey, because I agreed with what Klaus was saying on the potential role of Turkey as a hub. When you look at the regional position of Turkey, it's evident that a lot of gas streams will have to come through this country. And there is a lot of possibility, but it depends on whether you also do the things that are necessary to create a liquid market, and that is providing good infrastructure regulation, stable regulation, transparent regulation, and in the end, a price that can rely on demand and supply and is not dependent on the interests of one producer or one consumer. That's the first thing. A second thing is, when talking about the gas market in Europe, we shouldn't be talking about the gas market alone, but we should talk about the energy market. And we should look at the role that gas can play in the energy system. It's not a silo of electricity and a silo of gas and a silo of heat. It is one market that supplies customers with heat and power and comfort. And there, I think we should look at, when we look at the future of natural gas. In gas we trust, was said to me once by a commission official who did some very nasty things for gas, but he trusted on the fact that in the end, if all alternatives fail, there would be gas available. I think that is a bit simplistic, and it's not the right attitude, but it shows how important gas is in that system. And we should be self-confident that we can make gas play that role, but therefore the gas industry has to invest in innovative gas appliances, in appliances that make gas an essential part of that system where renewables have a large role to play as well. Thank you.